What is it that is the most difficult thing to do if you want to design a MOOC, or if you want to set up a MOOC, or buy yourself a way into a MOOC platform? The money. Now, this man here, Darko Jansen, is coordinator of EATU, and he's, well, he's actually coordinating 5 projects that sponsor this conference. So I ask you, listen carefully, connect, tweet to him, mail him, and join the conversation. Thank you. Darko.
So let me correct. I'm not a coordinator of the 5 projects. I'm only coordinating 2 of them. And I'm involved in another one. So no, I'm not coordinating of EDTU. I'm program manager at EDTU. And I'm trying to collaborate with as many MOOC projects as possible. So again, yeah, that's making me a kind of people in between, etc. But the main of the work is done by other people. I just try to connect that with one of the projects I'm involved in is with in the home project. That's more an expert knowledge network project where we bring people together. And in that behalf, I also try to have this sponsorship of those 5 projects to this summit. But don't be afraid, I don't talk about those 5 projects. We did have a panel this morning, we have a stand, you have the flyers in the participation kit, so no talk about the projects, only one slide at the end. What I want to talk about is European MOOC strategies and where are we standing in Europe? And the main subtitle is diversity indeed a strength in Europe, or is it a weakness? I think most of you will agree that the MOOC movement is dominated by the US. At least it seems that it's dominated by the US, with the main providers, Coursera, edX, Udacity, etc. And in Europe, the response is fragmented. Some universities are joining the US platforms, others are having their platforms at a country-based, a language-based, and some governments are involved in stimulating open education and MOOCs. It's not only Slovenia, not only French, there's also the Netherlands, Romania, and other countries are following. Then we have the European Commission, who almost 2 years ago launched the program Opening Up of Education, with 2 major calls: to innovate teaching and learning through the use of ICT, but also to reshape and modernize higher education systems through OER, MOOCs, and other forms of open education. And as a result, a lot of projects get funded by the European Commission. Not only DG Education, but also Horizon 2020 project, DG Connect, etc. I was trying to be complete with the list of MOOC projects in this. But there are a lot of projects that are not only dedicated to MOOCs, but have some topic on MOOCs as well. So the list is longer than I did here. The most recently started one are TRAMOOC and Locomotion. So they are not part of the sponsorship, but I have connections to them as well to make some collaboration with those projects as well. So I could start and finish this project, this presentation here, and say, okay, we have a fragmented policy in Europe. All institutions are doing something about MOOCs. We have a lot of platforms, a lot of projects, and that's it. But I like to be more optimistic. So my main cause for this, my main purpose in this 20 minutes is to make you enthusiastic about that we are where we are standing in Europe, that we can make a difference, and that we need to have some action on collaboration to make that happen. This is an article from Juan Manseco about the University of California, who had an online program, and it turned out to be a flop, according to this newspaper. Then there was another article about the hype is fading, and it's referring to a survey from the Babson Group, and it's stating that it's leveling off the number of institutions that are involved, with suspicion that it will not generate money and it's not sustainable, etc. And they, the Chronicle of Higher Education, said that it will have evidence and that with three charts. So on the top, on the red one, it's the reference to the US survey. And then I try to see what's happening in Europe, because all those surveys are about American MOOCs, what's happening in the US. And all the articles in the newspapers, most of them are about the US. What's happening in Europe? I already have some slides already yesterday in a short presentation in one of the parallel sessions. I will repeat two of the slides. Some of them are related to a study from the European Association of Universities, University Association, from Michael Cable, he's sitting there, from the report is published in November last year. And the other survey is done by one of the projects, Home Project, and is about institutional MOOC strategies in Europe only. Here's some slide about the characteristics of those surveys. The US survey is already there for 12 years, 13 years, I don't know exactly. It's about online education. There's a lot of institutions replying, but the MOOC questions are only related to those institutions who are having or planning to have a MOOC. Then we have the AUA study, and it's focused on e-learning, and they have almost 250 institutions replying, and have some answers on MOOCs as well. And then we have the study of the Home Project with only 67 institutions. I won't repeat all the results of the surveys and comparison, but I want to focus on certain issues related to the fading of MOOC hype in the US. And one was, MOOCs are not a sustainable method for offering course. That was the main result from the US survey at the bottom of this slide. In our survey, the European institutions are saying they agree or are neutral about a sustainable method for offering courses. Much more positive than the US side. Also, the other question is exactly the same question as in the US survey, is repeated in the Home survey as well. How well are MOOCs meeting institutions' objectives? In the US, in this 2013 survey, only 15% of the, only 30% said it will have meeting all of the objectives. And again, you can see that in our survey, the institutions are much more positive that they are indeed meeting some of the objectives related to MOOCs. So again, be positive, Europe is different from the US. We are more positive to MOOCs, and we also see it as a sustainable method as part of online provision and open education. But there's another difference, and that's a little bit biased, but I will mention it as well, because in the US, one of the conclusions is it's fading because the number of institutions that is offering MOOCs is decreasing a little bit, from 14% to 13.6%. But in Europe, we have now three independent surveys. One is from the AUA, who in their study stated that 58% of their institutions that replied said, we have a MOOC or we will develop MOOC very soon. So that's more than 50%. In our survey, which is biased, it is more than 70% of the institutions replied, we have a MOOC or we will develop MOOC very soon. And there's another survey now done by IPTS. I'm looking for Yves Pouny. There is not a final result yet, but there's a survey amongst the five biggest countries in Europe. And again, sitting there, again, about 50% of the institutions replied that they will be involved in MOOCs soon. So there's a large difference between Europe and the US. It may be biased, but there are three different studies all saying 50% or more of the institutions are going to be involved in MOOCs. That's a lot. So here see you the figure in the report, the difference between the US and in the home study. Now, if you look at one of the organizers of this conference as well, from Pau Education on their portal on Open Education Europe, they have the MOOC scoreboard. If you look at their figure of the number of European MOOCs at the bottom line and the total MOOCs in the world, you will see a significant increase the last 6 months. So an increase from 31% in the end of 2014 to almost 50% already for European MOOCs on their scoreboard. So the increase is already happening. So Europe is going to be in the lead. Be enthusiastic. We in Europe will be leading. Of course, it's only part of Europe. If you look at the scoreboard, it's mainly Western European countries. Eastern Europe is not that much involved. You can question why, I don't be on that, but if you look at the institutions replied in our home survey, again, Eastern Europe is missing for most of the part. So if you're looking at the 50% and also the big countries in the IPTS survey, it's mainly Western Europe. And Poland will be there as well. Poland is a big country and they announced to have many MOOCs the coming years. There's a bias. I won't talk about the bias, but one of the biases is that it's not defined what's a MOOC. So if you have questions about an institution and their MOOC policy, they can decide for themselves it's a MOOC or it's not a MOOC. So that may be dangerous because the American perception on a MOOC might be different from the Eastern Europe and Southern Europe, etc. So in our survey of the home project, we try to have the perception of institutions, what's a MOOC and what's not a MOOC. Also to validate a certain definition. So it's not about only what's a MOOC, it's also about what's a SPOC, even a research open online course, etc. This is a table from one of the reports from the Dutch SURF Foundation in 2014. And the number of abbreviations is not complete. We have a lot of more abbreviations on MOOC-type courses. So one of the results in the collaboration between those five MOOC projects is that we try to define what's a MOOC and what's not a MOOC. There is a paper on that on the internet. There is a flyer at the stand on to define, and also to define the criteria behind that. So I will do not repeat the definition. There are also criteria behind that, when it's massive, when it's open, when it's online, and when to define MOOC as a course. I want to focus on the massive level. I don't know if this is the most recent figure, but the record of the number of participants was more than 200,000 in the US. Was. Again, US was leading, but now who is leading? Europe. You already saw that in the figure, in the BBC news. One of the Future Learn MOOCs has more than 370,000 participants. I talked to Mike just before this session, and he said it's already more than 400,000. So, we are not behind the US. We have the record of the most participants in the MOOC. But then, it's all about English. What about the Lithuanian MOOC, for example? And my statement here is that the record is not at Future Learn for 400,000 participants, but the record is for a Lithuanian MOOC with 2009 participants. Why? You have to see it relatively to the number of speaking, native speaking in the second language, L1 and L2, and see how many percent of the people speaking that language is participating in a MOOC. Then the record is, I think, Lithuanian, but it can be a Dutch one. I don't know, because Dutch is not a very much spoken one as well. So, and that, again, focuses on Europe. Europe is not English language. We have 20, how many? 28, 25 different languages in European Union. And I want to focus on this one as well, because Lithuanian is in Eastern Europe, and we should encourage that Eastern Europe is making MOOCs as well. And this is a record one for me. But I know that opening up Slovenia, and Slovenia is making MOOCs as well. They will have that perhaps next, at the end of this year or next year. And there's less spoken languages. So be enthusiastic about those small countries as well, and small languages. That leads to the definition, what's massive. In the proposed definition we had with the projects, it's about already what's discussed. It has to be larger than 150, about the Dunbar number. But more importantly, a MOOC is a course. It's massive when it's designed to be for the massive scale, so that the efforts of all services does not increase significantly as the number of participants increases. So that makes a MOOC, and not if it's 400,000 participants or 2,000 participants. Let's go back to the late Lithuanian kind of MOOC. You see the figures on this. It started on the end of October last year. It has its own platform, so they don't need to have a Coursera platform that scales up to 400,000 participants. They can use a Moodle platform. But what's interesting is this one is that 31% did complete the MOOC, but also 16% of the number of enrollments did get a formal certificate to be paid for. So then you can say MOOCs are also about certificates, and even perhaps credits. But that might be confusion to a lot of people. I made some summary about the titles for certificates. So certificate of supplement and accomplishment, verified certificate, specialized certificate doing a capstone project, honor code, etc., etc. Sounds that confusing, the number of certificates? No. The Americans said it's confusing. The Europe institution said no, it's not confusing. Why? I don't know, but last week, or I think it was this weekend, was an interview with the Coursera CEO, and there's a statement that in 5 or 10 years, online credentials will be significant, and employees already are seeing that. So credentials, online certificates are going to be very important. Coursera, with their capstone project, is proving that it can make a business out of that. Is that also a business in Europe? Udacity is doing that with nano degrees. There was an interview with the site online in Germany with Sebastian, and it was not very positive. One of the aspects was that it was kostenlose bildung for alle, and now you have to pay for degrees, for nano degrees. So it's not for free anymore. So again, last week, announcement that FutureLearn and Pearson have an agreement, and that participants of a MOOC can pay £119 to get a verified certificate. So if you look at the cost for participants for a MOOC, you have a FutureLearn, 119, Coursera, you have the nano degrees of EdX, and you can have a verified certificate that you can see that you are the person who completed the MOOC, etc. But they are not part of a formal qualification from a university. They are not recognized yet in a bachelor of a master degree. But if you look at to the cost for full-time students per credit, per ECTS credit, in the UK, the fee for students is £9,000, or up to £9,000. In the Open University, it's somewhat below that. If you calculate that and you say an average student has about 15 ECTS a year, then it costs £600 a credit in the UK. And if you have a MOOC and a verified certificate with Future Learn, it's only £119. So that's profitable for the student if it's going to be recognized in a bachelor or master degree. But the fees in Belgium are not profitable for students, full-time students. For Germany, they don't pay a fee. So it's not a market for full-time students. If you look at the fees in Europe, of course, there are fees in high and very in the UK. Some countries are between 1,000 and 5,000 euros. But in some most countries, it's free or hardly any costs for full-time students. So again, Europe is different. Different from the UK and the US in this. This is an interview with the new vice chancellor of the Open University UK, who is warning about the loss of part-time students. So can MOOCs then be a solution to part-time students or to continuous professional development? I think it can be. But then, of course, we also have, in French, now President Hollande announcing a collaboration with Open Classroom, and that all online courses, not only MOOCs, are free for job seekers. So is there a market for credentials in Europe? Perhaps, but not in all countries, because we are seeing now, and it's the example in France, where it is a governmental led with FUN, now with Open Classroom for job seekers. It's a governmental involvement. In Europe, it's the social dimension. It's very important to have an inclusive society. So again, Europe is different. Some of the reflections in the home survey, and I think there's more and more confidence that this is true. More and more surveys, they are proving that European institutions are more involved in MOOCs than the US, or going to be more involved. That the number of institutions increasing, that MOOCs are seen as a sustainable method to offering course, they are experiencing a positive attitude towards MOOCs, and also see already some of their objectives realized. I didn't show the figures about the objectives, but the main objective for now is still visibility and reputation. But in Europe, it's also about innovation, innovate campus on education, innovating new kind of pedagogical approaches, targeting new students. And in the US, according to the Babson survey, it's mostly related to student recruitment next to visibility. So again, also the objectives behind MOOCs for an institution are different in Europe than the US. This is an article in Economist for, I think it was 1 month ago. I highlighted the phrase that the world is moving to the American direction, more universities and in more countries. And it's about the hunger for higher education, the need for higher education in more and more countries. But there is two systems in the world, the European system and the US system. And it's an article perhaps you should read about. And also it's about educational output related to research output. But the main conclusion in The Economist is, based on their figures, is that the American system is winning. So again, I think Europe, we should be different. As part of the home conference, we try to embrace Europe and the strengths of Europe, also there are risks, but also opportunities. And we had a conference in Porto, and we made a Porto declaration in how the 80 or 70 institutions that were present in Porto, how they can see how Europe can evolve in MOOCs and what's needed to embrace the opportunities on MOOCs and open education. The Porto Declaration is online. You can look at it. I think that more than 90 institutions or associations already signed the declaration or supported the declaration, I should say. And it's about embracing openness for a collective European response across Europe and also focusing on the opportunities for open education and MOOCs. So let me conclude you with just two slides. I don't know how much time I have left, but that's enough time, okay. I started my presentation with a subtitle, Diversity as a Strength. And there are three quotes from people who say it is. And it's the last two, what's triggering me on collaboration is the art of thinking independently together. So Europe is diverse, all the languages, etc., but it's the art of thinking independently together. And again, like Mark Twain said, it's the difference in opinion that makes horses race. So we don't want one platform, don't want uniformity. We should embrace diversity. Coming back to what the five projects are offering. Some of them are focusing on a decentralized model of a MOOC platform, like ECHO and OpenEdBet is doing. Not saying one platform, etc. On the other hand, we have Emma as well, saying we have one platform, but that is supported by different translation and languages services. So one platform that supports diversity. We have many different pedagogical and didactical approaches, not only XMOOCs or CMOOCs, but even SMOOCs in ECHO project. And S stands for social, seamless. Is there another S? I think that's it. We are focusing on the quality labels for MOOCs that embraces the diversity in approaches, like OpenEdBet is doing. We are training teachers in developing MOOCs, so not only MOOCs by the institutions and universities, but training teachers at schools to embrace the opportunities of MOOCs, like ECHO is doing. But also services on a questionnaire. So why develop every institution's own pre-test and post-test on a questionnaire for MOOC participants? Having a joint effort in that as well. And some results in my presentation is benchmarking the institutional and governmental MOOC strategies. Be collaborative in that as well. Building on expert networks, etc. The main issue is still removing barriers to learners, being inclusive, social mobility, equity, that are European values. Perhaps that are American values as well, but I like to stress it as European values. So my last slide is, how can we use diversity as a strength? I don't have the answer, but I think we should embrace diversity, many European platforms, many service providers. But again, it needs some kind of collaboration. We need some kind of framework where we can have a cohesive and collaborative effort. And it's not coming from the European Commission. It's perhaps coming with support from the governments. But it has to come from people and institutions working together. So we need some kind of proactive coordination for the diversity in MOOC services for all. And we should also embrace the diversity in solutions, in objectives of institutions, of target groups, etc. So it's a hard work. I was just triggered by one of the evolution theory. Why is there an evolution theory and why is diversity important? And one of the phrases said, diversity is securing evolution, but it's a slow progress step. So therefore, we are slower than the big American companies. But we are slowing, proceeding, going ahead
and making a better education system, hopefully. So that's my presentation.